Yeah, you're definitely going to want a Bible. We are talking about anthropology today and hamartiology. Different PowerPoint, we'll get to that. So a couple of notes of preface. This is following the new format we introduced last week. Of we're going more in depth, we're focusing more on just exegeting a few key scriptures, but we're not covering as much. So this is by no means an exhaustive study of anthropology. We're just pulling out a few key concepts of the nature of man, words about man. And this comes from Greek word. Anthropos, this means man, and ology, this is from logos, this means words. Words about man, there you go.
I don't know if Greek people say there you go.
They do. We saw it in a movie.
So.
Oh, Mario said once.
We're doing anthropology and hamartiology. This means study of sin, words about sin. Hamartias, or hamartia, I should say. But we'll get to that. Anthropology. Three things we're going to look at. The imago Dei, image of God. This comes from Latin words, imago, image, and Dei, God. So we're going to look at the image of God, and we're going to try and construct our theology. So like we were talking about last week, the difference between learning theology and doing theology. So we're going to try and do a little bit more of the theology instead of just me presenting the theology that has already been done. That necessarily means that we're not going to cover as much ground. So we've only got 3 points on the slide. It just seems so small to me. There should be like 30. But, oh well.
Well, 30 would be
on the lower.
Facets. We'll look at the facets of man. You guys know what facet means?
Aspects.
Aspects is a good...
Oh, cool.
The... Like a multifaceted person is someone who has many sides, many dimensions, many aspects to him. So like a diamond. I think of it like pieces, the pieces of man put together to form what man is. And then we're going to look at the fall, and that will segue into a discussion of hamartiology, the study of sin. So that's where we're headed. To start out with, imago Dei, the image of God. So the key text is Genesis 1, 26 and 27. So turn there in your Bibles. So you can get the context. What's happening in Genesis chapter 1?
Creation.
Yeah. What just got done happening in verses 1 through 25?
The beginning.
The beginning, yes. God created the heavens and the earth. What was happening in the beginning? How was the earth?
It was dark and void.
Formless and void, yeah. What was the Spirit of God doing?
He was hovering over the face of the waters.
And then what did God do?
He said that there be light.
And then what was there?
Light.
That's
amazing.
He just spoke it and it just like was there.
Yeah. Because God said so.
Mm-hmm. Would it be too complicated of a question for me to ask about the waters that he was hovering over?
Yeah, it would be an extremely complicated question. Deceptively simple, right? Don't know. It seems as though when God created the earth in verse 1...
It was without form and void.
It was a ball of water.
Because
we see later, right? Verse 6, let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters. Let separate waters from the waters. God made an expanse that separated the waters under the expanse of the waters that were above the expanse. So, essentially, it says he has water that's all over the earth. He separates them, puts water above and water below. And so there's a lot of discussion that goes into what is that water above.
We
understand what the water below is. That's the seas. But the problem is that we keep reading the story, and we see that in those days there was no rain on the earth. A mist rose up from the ground.
There weren't clouds?
I don't think so.
Then when it rain came down for Noah, that
was the waters above being returned to the earth. Most likely.
They had never seen
the
before.
That's so cool.
The deluge is what it's, the word uses. So yes, it's an extremely complicated question. The answer is, frankly, we don't know for sure. But all I'm sure is that he created the earth and there was water there.
Cool. Above Ambalo.
Above
Ambalo. And then he did stuff with it.
And then he causes the ground to appear out of the waters. It's part of the creation process. We see that in verse 11 or 9. So he created the dry land, and the waters were gathered together, he called seas. So he essentially gathers the water together, and where there's no water anymore, it reveals dry land. That's where we get land from.
Why? I have a question.
Yeah.
Why is it significant that he said he created the heavens and the earth? He separates heavens and earth.
Because there's multiple heavens and everything, and so there was nothing, so...
Yeah, but the heavens includes the earth.
So there's a couple different options. Heavens, Hashamayim. Shamayim is heavens in Hebrew. Can be used to just mean sky. Could also mean the literal dwelling place of God. There's a lot of discussion as to why it's plural. Mayim is plural heavens. It's not heaven.
It may also just be to signify or to make significance of that. This is the earth is like the main thing. So we created everything and then he created the earth.
Possibly, yes. I would actually say it's simply saying he created everything. It's a poetic, it's what's called a mirism, from the beginning to the end and everything in between. The heavens meaning everything that's above the earth and then the earth. What it's stating is that God created everything. That's how I would go with it. That's the doctrine I would draw from that significance. But
isn't it kind of saying that the water was there before he created everything?
No.
Because it said,
he created the earth and
the very first verse is, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth.
And then it says the earth.
And the earth was formless and void. The waters.
Oh, so what he first created was the waters.
Right.
And then he started
changing. He did stuff to it.
Yeah. So the earth, ha'eretz, this is the Hebrew word there, doesn't necessarily mean dry ground, earth. It means world, globe, can mean earth, dry ground, earth. It's got more of a wider semantic domain.
Thank goodness for Hebrew.
Semantic domain, range of meaning that a word can possibly have. So he creates everything, and then he gets to creating man. And he starts in verse 26. Creates everything, all the living creatures. We're on day 6 in verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image." I'm reading from the ESV, by the way, so if you've got different translations that seem significant, by all means, bring it up. "Let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds in the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them.
What does it say, our image?
Stop singing.
Good question. I'm going to give you the short version because we cover that in theology proper. But possibly because this is hinting at the Trinity in early forms.
Well, he didn't know. Oh, yeah.
Also possibly because he's using what's called a royal plural. In Hebrew, which where you use the plural to talk about yourself,
mm-hmm.
in order to bring majesty to the situation, like our lordships hands down a decree sort of thing, like the royal. Talk about yourself in the plural, and it adds to your greatness. The word for God in all these passages so far is Elohim, which is a plural. The ending im, anytime you hear the word im in Hebrew. At the end of a word, it's plural. So seraphim.
Jehoiakim.
Yeah.
Yes.
Plural.
Okay.
You know, seraphim, cherubim. That means multiple seraphs, multiple cherubs. Elohim.
I need more time to Christina, so I need the fourth one.
Is a plural that gets treated as a singular often as a proper name of God.
No.
Key word, he said, I can share them.
Isn't it great how cookies can...
You already have three. You have four.
Just destroy focus.
Okay, you should probably give some to my mom, or else she might hit you.
I mean, she will marry. It's not even.
But whatever you do with them, do it quickly.
So, sir, man, Josh, can I get one? Thanks.
We will return to you after this quick intermission.
Oh, quick, thank you.
Brought to you by Snickerdoodles.
Brought to you by Snickerdoodles?
The intermission was definitely brought to us by Snickerdoodles.
Just called you a rabbit.
Okay, rabbits can be intelligent sometimes.
My dad shot my rabbit.
Do you want him?
He did
shot
not.
Did you eat it?
Did
you just get so sick of it? Missed opportunity,
yeah. Rabbit is young.
Alright, everybody got your cookies? Everybody focused in?
Are
we back in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27?
Yes.
So, what does it mean when God says, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness? In his own image, he created them, him, male and female, he created them. What is included in the idea of the image of God? First of all, notice two words that he uses, image and likeness. That's verse 26, right? God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. So that's the first word question we got to ask. Is there a difference between image and likeness? What do you think?
Yes.
All right. Validate.
I would say image would refer to like having how more they look, and likeness would be inner like qualities.
Okay. And what justification within the text do you have for that statement? Not saying you're wrong. I'm just, whenever you validate, you got to validate from within the context of the passage. So.
Do you have definitions for these words? Because I have never looked at the definition of image or likeness.
Yeah, so he just provided what he would consider a definition of the word. So image would be referring to the form, the view, the look of something.
Like what you see with your eyes and
likeness would refer to the content, the personality, possibly, of something.
Yeah.
Of similar personality, whereas image would be of similar form, vision, sight.
I would switch those two.
Okay. You would switch those two?
Mm-hmm, because I guess you see, like, when you look in a mirror, you see your image. But I guess, I don't know.
But other people see your likeness.
But I mean,
I don't know.
Nope.
Did he have physical attributes at that point? I guess more the question is, was Jesus around?
Mm-hmm. Wait.
And if that's true, then...
So there you go. You're starting to drive at it. So does God have physical attributes that you could say image refers to the physical... visual attributes and likeness.
Say that in the passage, no.
Correct.
Just don't.
Are there parts of the Bible
John 1:1-4.
Of God? No, but that makes sense though.
What's John 1:4 say?
John 1:1-4. In the beginning,
you can sing it.
In the beginning was the word.
I'm not gonna sing it.
Sing it.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were made by him, and without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. John 1:4.
So who's the Word?
Jesus.
Second person of the Trinity. It makes it clear that he was there in the beginning. That's something we learn when we're reading this book and we get to John. Do we know that when we're reading Genesis 1?
No.
So God's human form was Jesus' human form?
I'm just throwing out questions to make you guys think. I'm also trying to look up a word at the same time.
God being in spirit, and you have to worship him in spirit.
Yeah, so then there's that other verse in John that says God is spirit. And he must worship him in spirit.
There's also that part in the Bible where Moses sees comes back.
Well, was the Holy Spirit around the entire time, like from start to finish, or was the was is the whole Trinity the whole Trinity was around?
Yeah, that's the Trinity.
I would say yes. We as 21st century Christians know from the full revelation of Scripture that the entire Trinity was present here at the act of creation, because of John 1 tells us that the Son was there, verse 2 tells us that the Spirit was there, and God generally is referred to as the Father. You can assume that the Father's there. And there would be passages in the Psalms that talk about the Father creating. So that's where we, with the whole revelation of Scripture, can say confidently, yes, the whole Trinity is present at this act of creation.
So we did have flesh in creation, so we could say we were made in the likeness of Jesus' bodily form.
Of his future incarnate bodily form, drawing off of his likeness, since
see,
they are
in mine it says, in the image after the likeness of God. Like, after, like...
What translation
like
do you
made
have?
After
ESV. What's that?
You do?
Which one?
We
could do the Spanish
non-stammer.
Yeah.
What?
Mine says,
say
in our image, after
our
likeness.
Let's make
man
our image
after our likeness.
Mine says,
the non-standard version.
In our image, in our likeness. Oh, dang.
It says, in our image, comma, after our likeness, right?
There's a comma.
So it's
yes, but it's a different.
It's the same. It means the same thing. Then.
In our image.
In our image.
After our likeness.
After our likeness.
Oh, right. Yeah. But like, does after, like, would that mean something other than like in our likeness, rather than like after our like after?
Oh,
likeness?
Be the mood.
Do that.
It's so it's the preposition be, It can mean in, can mean with, can mean after, depending on the context. There's no clear. So here's what some people would say. Yes, there's a clear distinction between image and likeness. And they would say, the Roman Catholic Church teaches this dogmatically, actually, that there's a difference between the image and the likeness of God. And so the image part refers to the bodily function, either pulling off of the idea of the future incarnate Christ as in his form, or they would just be a little bit more analogous. They would be less specific about what exactly. They say the material part of man, the body, the flesh, is definitely part of the image of God, but not really get real specific on where that comes from. Just say it's got to be there because the text says in his image, and then he creates flesh. So obviously there's some sort of link based on this verse.
I think a conversation me and Clint had up in Riggins, it was like there's like three forms of the human, and there's three forms of God. There's the flesh of God, the fleshy human, the spirit of God, the spirit of human, and the
soul.
I don't remember what the last one was.
Mind.
You were there.
I was. I didn't find it particularly compelling, so.
Exodus 33, starting with 8.
But I enjoyed the fact that y'all were digging in and doing theology.
God, Jesus, and the Spirit.
What am I looking for?
So,
creation.
What's the human equals to that?
Huh?
Yeah. What's the human equals to
So, the other view would be to say that there is no distinction between image and likeness, that they're synonyms of each other. There's no meaningful distinction. This is what I would lean towards, because likeness is not really repeated anywhere. It continues with the word image. I don't have a big problem with people who say that there is a distinction between image and likeness. I would just say validate it and justify it from within the context of this passage, that there's a difference between the meaning of the word image and likeness. Or within the context of the book of Genesis, each time that word occurs, go look it up in that context and see if it means something slightly different than the other. That would be how you do that. It takes a lot of work, a lot of study. All that aside, let's move forward with the assumption that they're about the same thing. What is involved, though? What goes into the image of God? What things do we see in man that we can say that is part of the image of God in us? We've talked about God. We've done theology proper, talked about his attributes, communicable and incommunicable, right? What things, attributes of God, qualities of God, would you say are reflected in man?
It says, so they can rule.
Okay, good. So we got dominion. That would be something that clearly, right there in the passage, making in the image of God. And the first thing he does is say, let them have dominion over the fish of the sea. So some sort of ruler, kingship, dominion, power.
You're in charge.
You're in charge of something. That would be an image of one of the aspects of the image of God in man. What else? And you can, for this question, let's go ahead and expand, not necessarily right here in this passage, but from the breadth of Scripture and logic, what would you say, knowing what God is and how man is, what things would you say are included in the image of God?
Having a soul.
Having a soul. Where would you get that?
The spirit.
What do you mean? Where'd you get the, where would you
like? Yeah, where'd you get the idea? So, you can't just pull things that, like, if you're going to go there, like, what's
a verse to back it up.
John, yeah, what's your validation?
Where does it say soul? Where does it say God has a soul?
I don't know.
Well, that's what he's asking for.
Exodus.
And I agree with you, but give some thought. How would you support the claim that having a soul is part of the image of God in us?
Yeah.
Where is
so
it?
Think. What were you thinking?
This has to be taken in context, but he created them male and female.
Okay, he created them male and female, which means that the two sexes are both represented in the image of God.
Oh, that's true.
Because he says specifically, in the image of God, he created them male and female, he created them.
So what does it mean by the image then?
Because exactly, that's what we're talking about.
Females look different, so how would that correlate with what he's saying about the likeness and the image? Because the likeness could make sense. But as far as how we know that guys look different than girls, how is that?
So we would say definitely the ways that guys look similar to girls would be
nose,
clearly.
Eyes, mouths, ears.
Arms.
Arms,
legs.
Arms, legs.
Every single human being
neck,
that ever lived.
Appendixes.
Hold their faces together.
Oh, Denise, what do you think?
Why don't you just speak?
Because I don't want to interrupt.
Just
so
that's never stopped any of us.
Yeah, that's wrong. That's not me.
No, it's because she's
don't tell me how to live my life.
Anyway, I've always looked at that as, okay, when you look at, like, typical characteristics of males, they're, like, heads of household, they're leaders, they're warlike, they're the ones who protect the family. You know, that's God is all of that. But then when you look at the typical characteristics of a female, nurturing, loving, kind, non-interruptive, God is that as well. And so in marriage, when the two become one, it's almost as if we're a picture of God as a whole.
Whoa, because it talks about how marriage is a big, it's like a big, like, I guess, metaphor or the other.
It's a reflection of the Trinity.
Yeah.
We talked about that when we talked about the biblical view of marriage.
Mm-hmm.
So I would agree with that suggestion. I would proceed with caution on what you attribute as the characteristics of male and the characteristics of female. I would agree that there are different ones in each sex.
Context.
Yeah. And the ones you listed, I don't have a huge problem with, depending on how the application of that plays out. You got to start treading carefully, but particularly in our age. But I would agree with that basic idea, that yes, the characteristics that we see in males and females add up to a sum total of we got them from God. But yeah, proceed with caution down that route, obviously.
You probably don't want to say that to someone who you don't know too well.
Or someone who knows.
Or if you do, if you do say it, make sure that you have evidence. Make sure you can validate that claim. That you can appeal to some sort of authority or natural law that shows that you are right in that assertion. But I'm digressing again. Well, so what do you, you mentioned soul, spirit. What do you think? I'm thinking of a particular verse pretty close to this context. It's in chapter 2, where it talks about the soul, sort of. I don't remember if we actually... Yeah, okay. You remember when God creates man, when we get the more detailed account of him creating Adam?
Oh, doesn't he breathe life into him?
Yeah, there you go. What verse is that? Chapter 2, verse 7. The Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the result of that, the man became a living creature.
Right.
So, life, in the way that it exists in humans, men and women, is distinct from life as it exists in animals or plant life. And it is a result of God breathing into humans.
Versus speaking
things into existence. So yeah, I would actually agree with your claim that the soul or the spirit, and you want to ask the question, okay, are we going to draw a distinction between soul and spirit? We're going to treat them as synonymous, but one or the other can be attributed to the breath of God within humans. I think that's logically sound.
In that picture above, what's around God?
Angels. This is Michelangelo's creation of Adam.
Are you supposed to look at it?
It's going to be up like this. So you're going to be able to get it to where you could look at it from any direction. Because it's up on the ceiling.
Oh.
I love that show.
Yes, I could. Yes. Care, but
I'm gonna move on past this question. Keep thinking about this. The fact that the image of God we created them. Also, one point of distinction to make: the image of God, what we know about God, that He is good, which means that the image of God contains no what?
Death.
Evil. Yeah, the contrast of good.
Darkness.
When He creates him, what does He step back and say?
He's good.
What does he say specifically about humans when he creates them?
Very good.
Very good. He adds the emphatic. Right. Until then, he's been saying, and he's created it and saw that it was good, created it was good, and then he gets to humans and he says, very good.
Well, you can just imagine, it's, you know, like, that's good. Yep, that's good.
That's good.
That's very good.
Some commonly proposed facets of man. First of all, there's the fact that humans exist in some sense in both a material and an immaterial being. So material being, flesh, body. Immaterial meaning mind, soul, will. Atheists, determinists, naturalists, think back to our worldview stuff, the naturalists who said that we evolved this way, it all just came about by random chance of atoms colliding, there is no immaterial part of man. There is only the material. And there are certain implications from believing that. If we are only material, then how do we account for what we would all call the soul or the spirit or the mind? These things that seem to be truly existent within humans that is not dependent on...
Only
exist in humans.
So are we only beings, are we only human because we have souls, or are we...
I would say that the defining characteristic of humans is that we're made in the image of God, and part of that image is that we possess a soul.
So God has created creatures that do not have souls, and we are the only ones that do.
Correct. Yeah, you won't see your dogs in heaven.
I'm
sorry to point that out, but your dogs don't have souls. They are not eternal beings.
If you really want to see your
family. Amen, brother.
I'm with you on that.
Yeah, I have a cat now, though. So.
Yeah, you do have a cat.
This is also part of why I'm so vehemently opposed to teaching theistic evolution, because the creation story and a lot of theology from it gets messed up if you really do believe that we came about by an unguided process and that our ancestors are monkeys. It directly contradicts what the text says, so you got a lot of... We're going to talk more about that in a little bit. But few ones that we're going to specifically dig into. The material, the body. Okay? My Bible fell. We've got the current body, which exists in a fallen state, which we're going to talk about the fall in a minute, but 2 Corinthians 4, 5 through 12, but we're going to first look at... we'll look at that one first. 2 Corinthians 4, 5 through 12. So turn there. Let's dig into that passage. How am I doing on time? What does 2 Corinthians 4, 5 through 12 say?
Okay.
Yeah.
For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed.
Listen to this verse.
We always carry around in our body, the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may be revealed in our mortal body. Through 15?
12.
Through 12. So then, death is at work in us, but life is at work in you.
So this is a key... Well, actually, there's a whole lot of passages that talk about the fall, but we're going to talk about the fall at the end of this. So keep that in mind. What we already know about the fall, just draw on your previous theological education on the fall. What did it bring us?
Death.
That's what entered the picture. So he describes our bodies in a couple different ways in this passage. Verse 7, we have this treasure. What treasure is that? Well, it's the knowledge of the glory of God from the previous verse. And we have it in what?
Jars of clay.
Jars of clay. What is he trying to make clear with this metaphor? Jars of clay. It's preserved, but describe a jar of clay.
Fragile, easily broken,
delicate.
Are we talking about delicate. Oh,
is it full
of clay?
Clay jar.
Yeah,
clay jar. Okay. Jar. A jar made of clay.
Whoa, this whole time.
Not Play-Doh.
This entire time, I thought it was
a jar full of clay.
Of clay. Like a jar with clay.
Yeah, no, a jar made out of clay.
They probably didn't even have a jar.
It was formed for a lot of time.
This would be what's called a material genitive, if you're wondering about advanced Greek grammar.
We are.
I learned something. So.
Is Greek close to Latin?
Not really.
Well said.
Sorry.
But he describes this treasure, the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus that we have in jars of clay. And then he goes on and he talks about how we are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. That this knowledge of the glory of God gives us some sort of power over this jar of clay. Jars of clay would be generally breakable, fragile. But the knowledge of the glory of God makes them stronger. But not completely imperishable. Because, verse 10, what we're doing is we're always carrying around in this body of death, the death of Jesus Christ, excuse me, that the life of Jesus may also be manifest in our bodies. A couple different ways you could be looking at this. You could relate this to Paul's teaching on baptism, right? Mm-hmm. What happens with baptism?
You're born again. You're transformed.
No.
What are the two phases of baptism?
You're
before and after.
You're dead and saved and then raised to life.
Buried with him in baptism and raised to new life in Christ. Yeah. You identify with him in death, descending into the waters, going under, like, into a grave, come back out representing the resurrection, raised to a new life. So that's one way you could be looking at this, of carrying around in our bodies the death of Christ so that the life of Christ may also be manifest in our bodies. That it's a reference to baptism. I think more likely what he's saying is we carry around in our bodies the reality of death exemplified for us in Jesus Christ, with the hope of the glory of God, the resurrection, that we also see in Jesus Christ, which will be seen in us, which we're going to look at in a second in 1 Corinthians 15 a lot more clearly. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake. We're always being given over to death for Jesus' sake. What do you think that means?
Self-sacrificing?
Self-sacrificing, possibly. They're being persecuted, possibly. We are always being killed off by the Romans for Jesus' sake because we refuse to deny his name. Self-sacrificing, we're always dying to self, living unto Christ, right? Giving up what we want in favor of what Christ wants for the sake of Christ. Possibility. So that the life of Jesus also may be manifest in our mortal flesh. Again, I think both of those are possibilities. I would say one of them... No, I wouldn't say that. Both of those are possibilities. You'd have to do some more validating within the context. Is persecution in view here? Has he been talking about persecution? That would lend credence to the idea that it's persecution. If he hasn't been, has he been talking about sanctification? If so, it would lend to the other view. Or is he talking about something else that we haven't thought of yet? That's a possibility too. I'm rambling here. Are you guys following me?
Okay.
All right. All that to say, there's clearly a current state of our bodies, a material part of man, and its current state is dying. Death now inhabits our mortal bodies. More on this later. Resurrection, though. This is a future material body that we will receive. 1 Corinthians 15. So go back a little bit to the book before. One of the coolest chapters in the Bible, 1 Corinthians 15. The context is really verses 1 through 26. And this one you actually do need to read. So we're going to do like we did last week. Everybody go to 1 Corinthians 15. Read the context and read the specific verses 20 through 26 again. And be thinking about what does this teach us about the resurrection? What are the facts about resurrection that we glean from this text? So go ahead and do that. Read the whole context and read the specific verses and be thinking about those questions. I guess.
Good riddance.
Mm.
Hey, oh, Isaac and Josh.
Is good riddance kind of like get riddance?
Like
to get rid of
ticklish.
Riddance?
Yes, yeah. Thanks.
Hey, Josh. No, I said bye to you and Zach. I said bye to you and Zach.
I said good riddance.
Hey, Josh, you should pass.
He's not.
But isn't...
Riddance is like the
epitome. I know, but is Riddick
okay.
Derivative?
Make your exit.
Bye,
guys.
So, are we talking about our resurrection or Christ's resurrection or resurrection in general?
Good question. Are we talking about our resurrection or Christ's resurrection or resurrection in general? I would say all three.
One of them.
In general.
So yeah, read 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 26, and then focus in on verses 20 through 26 and think, what does this mean for resurrection? Yeah, 1 Chronicles would be like a list of kings and what they would do.
One of the coolest chapters in the Bible.
Yeah.
Crazy.
typo in the Bible. To more than 500 the. It's literally the. No comma, no nothing. Just the. I think it's supposed to be of the.
Of the brothers.
Of the brothers at the same time. 500 the brothers.
There are no inspired translations.
True.
Just like salute when you're done. I keep saluting though, so.
You hope you salute once and then the cat, the superior salutes you back and then you can stop saluting.
Yeah, salute.
You just hold it.
Okay, if you're not done, quit asking questions about saluting and finish.
I was telling you about saluting.
I'm just going to turn the paper over.
So what do y'all think? What is the purpose of resurrection? What observations about a resurrected body can we make from this passage?
That death will be destroyed.
Death will be destroyed.
Death will no longer inhabit our bodies.
Okay, good. So in the resurrection, death is done away with. This thing that one of the defining characteristics of our current bodies will no longer be a defining characteristic in our resurrected bodies. Okay, good. What is the source of the resurrection?
A human? It says again, Christ.
Here, man.
Christ. There's one mediator between God and man. The man, Christ Jesus. Okay, so yes, Christ. What does it mean when it says first fruits? So look at verse 20. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. We've got two metaphors there. What are the two metaphors?
They've
First fruits. First fruits and falling asleep. Okay, what's the first fruits a metaphor for?
The first in line.
The first to be raised permanently.
Like the first.
Right, yeah, the first of them. What does the term come from?
The day when they gave the best of their crops.
The first gathering.
Yeah, it more generally just means the first of the fruits that you gather from your field. Those are your first fruits, the first ones to show up. And they are a promise of further fruits. When you harvest the first fruits, you're expecting more fruits. Otherwise, you would just call them fruits, not first fruits, right? So that's it's an agricultural term. It means the first ones that sort of give us a down payment, a promise that more are coming. So he says, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. What is fallen asleep a metaphor for?
Death,
most likely. This is a euphemism for death. I tend to think that there's a little bit more of a literal sense to it. I think people actually do fall asleep in a sense when they die. But I'm crazy and weird, so don't listen to me on that.
Don't say that.
What?
Don't listen. I mean, whatever. I don't know.
Don't take my word for it on that. Come to that conclusion on your own, because I disagree with the vast majority of Christians on that point. So Christ is the first fruits, and what is this? He the first fruits of?
Being resurrected,
being raised from the dead. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of death. What does he mean? Well, he explains in verse 22, for as in Adam, all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. It's referencing back to Genesis chapter 3. Again, if there is no literal Adam, first guy who is created, the first one to die, this theology makes no sense. And I point that out because the reason I had you read the whole context was, what is this all about? What particular doctrine or thing in Christianity is this thing about the resurrection a primary category of? It's in verse 1 of chapter 15. The gospel. What is the gospel? Well, it is this: that Christ died, this is verse 3 of chapter 15, for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried, like we saw him die. He was buried. That's how we know he died. He was raised from the dead, as implied, on the third day, in accordance with the scriptures. And how do we know that? Well, he appeared to Cephas and the 12. So just like we know that he died because he was buried, we know that he raised because he appeared to Cephas and the 12, and then 500 others, and then to me. In accordance with what?
The scriptures.
It is because it was written in the scriptures that this occurred. It is also because this occurred that it was written in the scriptures. Both are a description of each other. But the gospel, the fact that Jesus died and rose again, is absolutely essential to Christianity. And then Paul goes on, and as he's describing the gospel, he also says the way this works out is that death came through Adam, the first man, and life came through Christ, the second man, or the last Adam, as some people call it. This is very closely linked. This is, again, why when you start spiritualizing chapters 1 through 3 of Genesis, you get into really sticky water with
sticky
the rest
water.
Of theology. And I mixed my metaphors there, sorry. Soul, spirit are the immaterial part of men. Genesis 2:7, he breathed into the nostrils of man. We already looked at that one. Matthew 10:28 says, do not fear them who can kill only body and then have nothing left to kill. Fear him who can kill both body and soul and cast into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. And then he says, do not fear, for you are more valuable than many sparrows. Right? How much are sparrows worth? A couple pennies, but God looks after them. Do not fear, you are more valuable than many sparrows. Conscience. This is one that we don't talk about much in the church, so we're going to focus in a little bit on it. Romans 2. So turn there in your Bibles to Romans 2.
Romans.
read verses 14 and through 16 with me. The context of Romans 2 is that he's laying out sin, how it came about, that people knew the truth, suppressed it in their hearts, and rebelled. We'll talk more about sin in a little bit. But verse 14. Now he turns to the Jews and he talks about them and how they know about sin because of the law. And if you're going to follow the law, you got to do all of the law. And by the way, you can't do all of the law. And what about Gentiles? So that's what he's turning to now, verse 14 of chapter 2. For when Gentiles who do not have the law by nature do what the law requires, they are a law to themselves, even though they do not have the law. They show that the works of the law is written on their hearts, while their conscience also bears witness, and their conflicting thoughts accuse or even excuse them. On that day when, according to my gospel, God judges the secrets of men by Christ Jesus. So he specifically says, everyone, Gentiles included, have a conscience. It either accuses them, tells them, you did something wrong, that little voice that says, you just broke God's law there. Maybe not in so many words. But you need to fix it. Or it excuses them. It clears them of that charge. It lets you know, oh no, you didn't do anything wrong. You have a clear conscience. Conscience is not a bad word. Lots of people in the church don't like to talk about conscience, but Paul does right here and in a couple other places. I don't really know. That seems some people...
Because a lot of people use the idea of conscience over the Holy Spirit. That our conscience, is telling us that we're wrong. Well, is that some mystical thing, or is it the Holy Spirit who's convicting us?
Yeah.
So I think that's why. I'm not sure, but...
Well, another thing, lots of Christians would link the two, where I don't think that they're the same. I think, as he says right here, Gentiles who don't have the Holy Spirit, they do have a conscience. Conscience is, he describes it as the law written on their hearts.
So, a sense of morality.
Yeah, the moral law, natural law.
Thing.
Which is a thing, yeah.
So then why would it happen?
Yeah.
Why would it be such an issue to talk about?
I don't really know, but I just know that lots of people don't like to. But yeah, your conscience is definitely a guide of morality. It lets you know what's right and what's wrong. And I would say the point of the resurrection is to return freedom to you that you may once again follow the promptings of your conscience. We'll get into that in a little bit. More to come. Do I have time for that? Yeah, we're going to have time for that. What about will? Does man have a will? Interesting thought.
Just watch Unbroken.
That's a good movie.
It is a good movie. Unbroken, the guy who goes to the prison camp in like Japan or something. And there's the board and he had like
the railroad tie.
He goes down to the killers, they shoot him, and right before he goes and he goes investigate. And then the guy beats him up with a stick.
Stop looking at me!
I know.
Romans 7 talks about Paul struggling with what he wants to do and what he does not want to do. One of the coolest passages.
Oh, yeah.
And this also feeds into the facets of man. So we get a glimpse into Paul's being here. We know that Paul is regenerate. We know that he has the Holy Spirit. So this is describing a believer who has the Holy Spirit. How does he describe himself? Starting in verse 14. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold under sin. For I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law, that is, it is good. So now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the laws of God, in my inner being. But I see in my members, my flesh, another law, waging war against the law of my mind, and taking me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh I serve the law of sin. The word, the Greek word here is thelo. I wish, I will.
What's the law of sin?
Interesting question.
What did you ask? What's the law of sin?
I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh I serve the law of sin. So I'm spitballing, but I would venture a guess that the law of sin here would be sin in general, the commands that require action in a sinful way. So if you were to, it's probably not a literal, like, defined thing, but if you were to create a contrasting law from the law of God, what is good versus what is evil, he's talking about the things that are prescribed evil, things that you shouldn't do, would be the law of sin. That's spitballing.
I would think it might have something to do, too, like on top of that, with, it's like when someone gives us a rule, okay, do not do this. Well, our flesh, our sinful nature, wants to automatically do that.
Yeah.
And so it's almost as if, like a law of nature, it just, it happens. That's something that's a little bit, because of our sinful flesh, it's uncontrollable in us. When we see something that we're supposed to do, or when we hear a rule, we always...
We desire to do the opposite. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I agree with that. But the question is, does man have a will? Some sort of a free... will. I would say, yes, man does have a free will. Man is always free to act in accordance with his nature.
I want to have a servant named Will.
What?
You definitely want to work for free. That's slavery, man.
All creatures are free to act according to their nature. I get this from Paul right here. I do not do what I want to do, but I do what I do not want to do. The will always chooses according to its strongest inclination at the moment. That's Jonathan Edwards, so I would agree with him on that. Man has free will but lacks liberty. What he's saying there is liberty would imply he doesn't have the ability to do good. He only has the ability to do evil. So he's freely allowed to do what he is able to do, and what he's able to do is evil. I think this concept of freedom of the will is right. I have not fully developed it as I understand it. It's quite a Calvinistic doctrine, so heads up, that's where this perspective comes from. This idea gets developed in Calvin. But there's a poem that kind of illustrates it. Kitty cat, where have you been? I've been to England to see the Queen. Kitty cat, what saw you there? I saw a mouse under her chair. I said the her chair. It should just be her chair.
And you also said kitty cat, kitty can.
Seriously?
Is there anything else to that?
Kitty cat, kitty
can. Fail, Stephen.
Were you retired when you wrote this? Because I can't.
I copied them straight from my class notes when my professor presented this idea. And so I was typing pretty fast. That's probably why. Kitty cat, kitty cat, where have you been? I've been to England to see the Queen. Kitty cat, what saw you there? I saw a mouse hiding under her chair. The point is, what did the cat see? He saw what his nature inclined him to see. As a cat, you're going to see the mouse, not the Queen, right? Creatures are always free to act according to their nature, and they will act in accordance with the strongest inclination at the moment, as Edward says. And I would say that humans, in a fallen state, their strongest inclination is always to sin. So Do humans who are non-believers have free will? Yes. They are free according to their nature to sin. So they can sin in all kinds of free and interesting ways. But they cannot please God. They are in rebellion against God. We'll talk more about sin in a minute. So it's so hard to do anthropology and hamartiology separately because there's so much overlap. Yeah. That is how I answer the question of do humans have free will. After being given a new nature, as Paul calls it, you have two natures at war within you, like he talks about. Spirit and flesh. And so humans who are believers of the gospel, who do have a new nature, are free to act in accordance with either of their two natures at the moment.
So then we have two natures?
Yes.
One of flesh and one of spirit?
Yeah.
But, yeah, okay. So then why is there the question of if we still have a sin nature or if we don't, if we...
I don't think there is a question. I think we do. I would say Romans 7 is proof of that, but... And then the ultimate thing, the resurrection, what do we look forward to? A day when the flesh will be redeemed also. So at this point in time, only the spirit has been redeemed, not the flesh. And when we get to the resurrection, resurrected bodies, the flesh will also be redeemed. It will also be made new. So then we will only have one nature, and it will be a holy nature, a non-sinful nature. So we will only be able to act in accordance with that nature. We will not be able to sin. Does that make sense? So I haven't dug into this concept as much as I would like yet, but I think this is a good way of expressing the idea of how does the human will act? It acts in accordance with this nature. But we're running out of time, so we're going to move on. The fall. Talked a little bit about this already. I want to dig in just a little bit, though, in chapter 3. Yeah, I like this painting, The Fall of Man by Michelangelo, but we've got younger viewers here, so I got to censor it.
You should have used more period-appropriate leaves.
The coloring isn't
good. It's more supposed to be humorous than... I think you guys are mature enough to handle it. I just thought it was funny to do that, so I did.
You knew the comment on it.
Yeah. Genesis chapter 3.
But we commented on the leaves.
Okay, I'm going to read you one verse from earlier, chapter 2, and then we're going to read chapter 3 along together. Genesis chapter 3 is the second most important chapter in the Bible. The only more important chapter would be Revelation chapter 21. Genesis chapter 3 is where the whole story sets up and takes place, and all of the theology in the Bible starts in Genesis chapter 3. And so, again, this is why it's really dangerous to start spiritualizing and taking this like it's not history. But before we read chapter 3, I want to read you something that God told man to do. Chapter 2, verse 15. The Lord God took the man, singular, the man, and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." That's the one of the commands he did. Then he creates woman. So we get the creation of woman story. We have the marriage. You are bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother, hold fast to his wife. They shall become one flesh. The man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. Now, verse 1 of chapter 3, the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God actually say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat from the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat from the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die.' But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will surely not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. You will become like God, knowing good and evil.' So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, or to give insight, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and they made themselves loincloths. What were the causes of the fall? So that's the fall. What caused it?
Wanting to be like God.
Wanting to be like God. Amen.
Pride.
Pride. Good summary word for wanting to be like God. Where is that in the text?
You will be like God.
Who said that?
The serpent.
The serpent said that to Eve. So where does the text tell us what Eve's motivation for eating the fruit was? What verse?
Said it looked good and was something
and also desirable,
give her insight,
gaining wisdom. Yeah,
yeah, to make one wise, to give her insight. Verse 6. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate it. So there were three things that. Good for food, delight to the eyes, and then the one that relates back to what the serpent had said, you will be like God, knowing good and evil, desire to make one wise. That is the essence of the fall, that is what caused it, is wanting to be like God, wanting to know good and evil. And the word know there could also be translated revealing good and evil, to make known, right? Depending on the stem. To know, I would suggest the concept of determine. How does God know good and evil?
He knows everything.
He knows everything, but where does?
Because
he is good. It is his very nature that determines what
is
good.
Him is bad.
Anything that is not of him is what's evil. So. Really, there's an element of when you know good and evil like God knows an evil, you're determining good and evil by your nature. So, I would suggest that there is an element of Adam and Eve not only wanted to be wise, wanted to be like God, they wanted to be like God in that they wanted to say, they wanted to determine what was good and what was evil. That's me talking.
Control.
They wanted to live... They wanted to create their own reality instead of living in the reality that God created. That's one for me. Feel free to quote that all you want. She took the fruit, gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. I put here, what were the causes of the fall? So, desire to make one wise, knowing good and evil. There's an earlier cause that kind of sets this whole thing off. What's the first thing that the serpent asks Eve?
Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?
Yeah, did God really say, first of all, did God really say is one of those things that you can tack on to any of these questions of our society. Did God really say, fill in the blank, and pretty much any of the major conflicts in our society can be started with that phrase. Did God really say that homosexuality is a sin? Did God really say that you shall not have abortion? Did God really say that there's only two genders, male and female? He created them.
Case, did God really say that we should kill all homosexuals?
Yeah.
That's pretty much.
But that aside, asking the question, did God really say this, is not necessarily wrong. How you answer that question is either right or wrong, and it's based on what he actually said. Right? So he asks the question, did God really say, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden? Well, no. We know that from earlier. God didn't say that. What did he say?
Don't eat from the tree in the center of the garden.
Yeah, and right before that, you may eat, surely, from every tree of the garden, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. You shall not eat from it, for the day you eat of it, you will surely die. How does Eve answer the serpent's question, did God really say, you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?
No, we just can't
touch
it. You can't eat it, and you can't touch it either.
Yeah. So
she embellished.
She embellished. She added.
And she also didn't. Maybe negativity, like she focused on the negative. This is what we can't do, not, oh, we can eat from everything else. This part is good. God provides everything we need. So she focused on the what she couldn't do.
Possibly.
I mean, I don't know what that would be called.
But she does specifically say, mm-hmm. we may eat from the tree, from the fruit of the trees in the garden. But God said, you shall not eat from the tree that is in the midst of the garden, which is exactly what he said.
Yeah.
Then she adds the phrase, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. So, one of the other causes of the fall was adding to God's word. There's some sort of communication breakdown between Adam, to whom the word was given, and Eve, to whom either a different word was given or a different word was understood. But he tells that to Adam, right, before Eve exists. Tells the man, don't eat from any tree in the garden. And then he creates woman, and we don't see God telling the woman. This is part of where Paul goes in 1 Timothy of why women shouldn't preach the word. He builds it off of this idea that man was created first, he was given a word to, part of man's job is to interpret and teach the word of God. And he says specifically, when woman did it, we got the fall. It's part of the created order.
Maybe, did she maybe add in, don't touch it for, temptation reasons?
Yeah. Well, the question, where does it come from? Maybe we can speculate. Did Eve add to the word of God, or did Adam add to the word of God? When Adam was giving the instruction to Eve from God, we're not supposed to eat this fruit. You know what? Don't even touch it. Let's just keep you safe. Let's not touch it. Don't even think about eating it. We'll build a little fence around it. We'll call it the Talmud. No. But regardless, whichever one of them added, that was clearly a factor in this horrible thing, the fall. So those were some of the causes. What were the results of the fall? Let's see, what does the text actually say? So let's skip down to... Actually, I'll just read it, and then we'll dig into verses. Verse 8, they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden, the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of God from amongst the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, where are you? And he said, I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. He said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you not to eat? The man said, the woman whom you gave to me to be with me, she gave me the fruit of the tree, and I ate. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this thing you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. So then he turns to the serpent. He starts dishing out curses. The Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all the beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, you shall bruise his heel. That's Jesus, by the way. We've dug into verse 15 of chapter 3 many times, so we won't do that today. But to the woman he said, I will surely multiply your pain in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. And to Adam he said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife, and have eaten of the fruit of the tree, of which I commanded you, you shall not eat it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you. You shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken. For you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Man called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. The Lord God made Adam, and for his wife garments of skin, and clothed them. And the Lord God said, behold, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil, lest he reach out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat it and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him out from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he was taken. He drove out the man, the east of the Garden of Eden, He placed a cherub and a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. So, what were the results of the fall? Let's start with the serpent. What curse does the serpent receive?
He will crawl on his belly and eat dust.
And sorry, what?
He will be cursed over all
livestock. Cursed over all livestock. And what else? He will bruise the heel of the seed of the woman, and he will receive a crushed head for his troubles. Yeah, that's crucifixion and resurrection, just in case you didn't know. What's the woman's punishment?
Pain and childbearing.
Pain and childbearing, and?
She'll want to be a man.
Yeah, there's this kind of awkward phrase in many English translations, your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. And a lot of work can be done in understanding what that means. I'll just tell you what I think it means. I think it means that man is supposed to be the head in the relationship between man and woman, in the husband-wife relationship, I should say. And woman's desire is going to be to take that role, to lead instead of follow. And kind of what we're going to see is that man's going to want to do it. Man's going to want to let him. His curse would be that he's supposed to lead and he's going to want to follow. He'd much rather just sit on the couch and let the woman do all the work. But that was colloquially put. What's Adam's curse?
Curse and ground.
The ground gets cursed. And what changed in when he's dishing out curses between Adam and Eve? Did you notice the way that God started each of these three curses? He started the serpents and the man's in the same way. What word starts out both of those curses?
Cursed.
Cursed.
Because you have done this.
Because you have done this. He gives the justification, the reason for each curse to the serpent and the man. He doesn't do that for the woman. I haven't figured out why that is. I just noticed that there's a difference. With the man and with the serpent, he gives the rationale of why this curse is being received. I haven't figured out why he doesn't give the rationale to the woman. Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree, of which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. What does the phrase "because you have listened to the voice of your wife" mean?
It says
obeyed. Obeyed is probably a better translation.
You have relinquished your
headship.
Headship.
Yeah, you did it. Like, you were supposed to be leading and you followed. So because you followed instead of leading, it does not mean husbands, you're not supposed to listen to your wife. Okay?
That's exactly what it means.
Just tune it out. The Bible says to do it. No.
Uh-huh. I have heard that not blaming Eve, that makes any sense, but that because Adam was the first created, because God gave him the command,
the instruction,
right, that he was supposed to be protecting and taking care of his wife, that the fact that Eve was there alone and Adam wasn't there going, hey, don't listen to this thing, don't listen to this serpent, not protecting her, that maybe that he was a bit more culpable.
I would say what's even worse is that she wasn't there alone.
Yeah.
Text specifically says, gave to her husband who was with her. So he was standing right there letting this happen, and he was supposed to be protecting her. Yeah, but everything else he said is exactly correct. He wasn't there interceding. He was not leading, he was following. But what's his curse? Who gets a curse because of the man?
Wait, what?
Who gets a curse because of the man? The earth. Because you've listened to the voice of your wife, etc., etc. Cursed is the ground because of you. As a result, you'll eat of it in pain all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, so you're going to work and try and get food from it, but it won't be very easy or prosperous. You shall eat the plants of the field. This is going to change in chapter 8 when we see Noah, or maybe 9. No, 8. When we see Noah get off the ark. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Death enters the picture. Yeah,
mine says eat food.
Yeah.
By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food.
It caught my eye. I wanna look that up and see if it's the exact same word as Deuteronomy, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. I have to check that because I don't know Hebrew well enough to say, oh yeah, the Hebrew word here is. That's the result. What's one of the last results of the fall? Get kicked out of the garden. And why is that important? What are they actually being kept from?
The tree of life.
Tree of life. That is extremely important because in the last chapter of the book, we see the tree of life come back. It shows up here. The whole reason that they get kicked out of paradise is to keep them away from the tree of life. And in chapter 21, 22 of Revelation, the tree of life is back. That's where we're headed. That's the whole point. Eternal life. Resurrection. Life. Everlasting. We've got 5 minutes. I don't think we're going to be able to get through all of hamartiology in 5 minutes. So, what I'm going to do is just wet your whistle, and then we'll pick up with hamartiology next week. But
is that a leaf?
It is a leaf. The idea being like the tree.
Oh,
that's why I picked that background. We're going to skip to the inheritance part. So this is the question that we're going to start with next week, is how do we inherit sin? Most of you grew up going to Northwest Bible Church, which teaches the doctrine of original sin, that humans are born with a sin nature. That was not always a fully formed doctrine in the church. There is a controversy between Pelagianism, and Augustine, which you've heard his name before. And they were going back and forth. Are humans born naturally sinful or not? So we're going to dig into the question of how exactly do humans inherit sin next week. To wet your whistle for it, look at chapter 1 of Genesis. When the animals get made. Verse 24 of chapter 1. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things and beasts of the earth, according to their kinds. So it was done. God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps according to its kind. God saw that it was good. This repetition of the phrase, according to its kind, is quite common in the first three chapters of Genesis. The fall happens. Adam and Eve have two kids, Cain and Abel. Cain kills Abel. We're wondering how exactly this comes about. In chapter 3 is this like census data almost. And we've talked about this before with the story. The repetition of the phrase, and he died, right? Seth had lived so many years, he had so many kids, he lived so many more years, and then he died. And then his kids had so many years, so many kids, and then he died. So many years, so many kids, and then he died. And then he died, and then he died, and then he died, and then he died. This repetition over and over and over again, driving home the point that everybody's dying, and it's all a result of chapter 3. The question is, though, how do they inherit this death? Well, I'm going to submit that it's at the beginning of chapter 5 sort of answers this question. This is the book of the generations of Adam. When God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. Male and female, he created them, and he blessed them and named them man when they were created. When Adam had lived 130 years, he fathered a son in his own likeness, after his image, and named him Seth. So, in whose image was Seth made. Adam's. How is Adam's image after verse 3? Sinful. Corrupted. The image of God has received some sort of twist. So,
now it's Adam's.
And now everyone's being made in Adam's likeness. Adam's image. A sinful one. This plays into the theology of why was Jesus immaculately conceived? Why didn't he have a human father? Some people would say, because we had to keep Adam's image, the male, from being passed on. That's where the sin comes from. This plays into Paul's theology of first and last Adam. All humans receive this condition, this image, given to them by Adam, passed on by Adam. But exactly how does that work? We're going to dig into that next week with hamartiology, and we'll probably start into soteriology next week too, and then finish up soteriology in the following week. So.
And I'm just saying, as a parent, you guys don't know this, but as a parent, if you don't believe that that child comes out selfish, oh my gosh, wait till you have kids. Because
or have younger siblings.
Well, that too, but it's true. For at least for me, it's different having your own child because you're responsible for that child.
Oh.
So
we don't have to be.
Our heritage of glory.
Yes, I know, but they're sinful from birth.
Good job.
Yeah.
It's true.
I was so selfish.
Quit crying. Your older brother is a doctor. What are you, a baby? Get over yourself.
Is that from something?
No.
Okay.
When have you known me to quote stuff?
It just seems so specific.